Endangered is a poignant, cooperative dice placement game with the theme of saving endangered species, and it's one of the best cooperative games we've ever played. Stick around after the core review for our thoughts on the Monarch Butterfly expansion as well.
Endangered was designed by Joe Hopkins, features artwork from Ben Flores and Beth Sobel, and is published here in North America by Grand Gamers Guild, who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy of this game even before they became a sponsor of our show.
This conservation-themed game plays 1 to 5 players, with games taking an hour more at higher player counts and much quicker when playing solo.
We would call Endangered family-friendly. While it has some meat on it and falls into a medium-weight Euro range, due to the accessible theme, we think it will appeal to kids who can be helped by parents and experienced players, since this is a cooperative game.
So in Endangered, players form a team of conservationists working together to save a species from extinction. The base game includes 2 species, tigers and otters. Players will have to deal with hazards like deforestation and pollution, the impact of poachers and oil spills, and more. While dealing with these calamities, the team must also try to influence UN members to take action and pass new legislation. The game is won if you can get enough members to vote yes to conservation before the species is wiped out or you run out of time.
You can get a look at the components in this wildlife conservation board game by going over to our Endangered unboxing on YouTube.
These include a double-sided board and destruction tiles, D6 dice, various cards including UN cards, cards for each role, impact cards for 2 of the scenarios, money tokens, wooden influence cubes, and awesome wooden animals, and a meeple, if you will, featuring little wooden tigers and otters.
I have no complaints at all about the components in Endangered. Card quality is good, card design is even better. I actually really love the iconography on this game. It is very clear and easy to read from across the table, even with my aging eyes. Rulebook is also noteworthy for its clarity.
The first step to playing Endangered is to pick which species you want to save and your difficulty level. The base game box comes with 2 options, either tigers or otters. There are more species available through various Endangered expansions, as well as some fan-created content you can find on BoardGameGeek.
Place the board on the appropriate side. Set it up based on the appropriate scenario card. A random set of 6 UN cards is placed along the top of the board, and each player chooses a role to play, including the environmental lawyer, lobbyist, philanthropist, TV wildlife host, and zoologist.
Players grab all their stuff for the role and choose one of the role's specialty cards to use for that game. This will also have them find and play 1 card from their deck. Now, each card played in this game either becomes a new action space for everyone to use, instantly gives you something, or becomes a permanent effect that stays in play the whole game. Once everyone's played their card, they all shuffle their decks and draw 2 cards. The group then decides who goes first.
No matter which scenario you pick, the goal of Endangered remains the same. Get 4 UN delegates to vote yes to conservation efforts during a voting year. Each game only features 2 of these, and if the vote doesn't pass by the 2nd voting year, your group loses. You will also lose if the species is wiped out.
Each turn starts with the active player rolling their dice. They then place them 1 by 1 onto action cards to activate them. These can be the actions pre-printed on the board or action cards brought into play by the players. Each player can only have 1 of their dice on each card, and a played die must be higher than any dice already on the card. This is a key part of how Endangered works.
Now, the basic actions on the board let you draw cards or get money, move animals, play a card from your hand, or remove devastation tiles. When the play a card action, players will add new action spots to the board, opening up all kinds of other options, like discarding cards to move 2 animals 2 spots, earning money by working, paying money to draw and play a card, removing devastation tiles by spending influence, and there'll be multiple cards that let you play Influence Cube on those UN cards.
Placing Influence Cubes onto the UN cards is the way you win the game. The cards start face down and are revealed when they get their first cube placed onto them. Each card will list a target number. To get to this number, you will have to add something to the Influence Cubes on the card. The something varies by nation, and it could be the number of animals on the board, the number of mating pairs, the amount of devastation, a randomly rolled number, the amount of money the players have, and more.
Now, once active players have spent their dice, you roll for offspring. The more mating pairs you have, the better your odds. Then it's time for bad stuff to happen. You pick a row or a column on the map and roll a die, then add a devastation tile on the appropriate spot. If there are animals there, they're lost.
Next, a card is drawn from the impact deck. While some of these are good things that will help you out, most are quite nasty and make things harder. Now, some of these cards are one and done. Others, though, are persistent impacts that stay in play. The stacking of multiple persistent impacts can be quite deadly to your species.
Then, finally, the active player draws a card from their deck and picks the next player to go. Once all the players have gone, which is tracked by turn markers, you get to the end of the year. And if it's a voting year, you resolve the UN cards left to right. And if you have 4 yes votes, you win.
If it's the second voting year and you don't get 4 votes, your game is over. Otherwise, you move to the next year and the player who went last chooses who starts the next round and play continues.
So that's the gist of Endangered that pretty much applies to all different versions of the game and scenarios. Because this is an exception-based game. And a lot of those exceptions come from which scenario you're playing. As an example, from the base box, the Tigers have a special rule that after producing offspring, they have to split up. The cards in play and the different characters' special abilities can also modify the rules we just covered. Now, the big thing that drew me to Endangered is the theme. This feels like an important game because it has an important theme. A theme that may actually get people talking about conservation. And potentially even getting someone to start doing something about it. That on its own makes me like this game.
Yeah, the theming on this one is solid, and I'd go so far as to say it's downright educational.
I mean, it has otters, so I was on board from the start. But add to that the powerful awareness of the issues that this game brings, and really it's a no-brainer.
Now, even better than that is the fact the gameplay is great, like fantastic. This is honestly one of the best cooperative games I've ever played. And it's even managed to win over some people from our gaming group who usually aren't fans of cooperative games, like Deanna here.
Yeah, there are a handful of cooperative games that I won't actively run and hide from, but I can't think of many that I would ask to play. And this one makes the very short list of co-ops that I would actually suggest that we play.
While Grand Gamers Guild is a sponsor, one of the reasons they're a sponsor is because we usually like their games. This one is no exception, as the game manages to be socially impactful and fun to play, which, as anyone who's played educational board games in the past knows, isn't an easy balance to strike.
Now, I think a big part of what makes Endangered shine is the dice placement mechanics, specifically 2 key parts of that. The first being the number of actions. The number of worker placement spots actually grows as you play. And the way it grows is through direct efforts of the players. It's not like new spots just unlock as you play the game.
Yeah, I like the way your action selection tree grows throughout the game and how with multiple plays, it doesn't feel too samey.
Now, the second key part of why I think Endangered's been such a big hit with us is the dice placement mechanic, the way the dice work. The fact you can't place a die on an action unless it's higher than all other dice there has a huge impact on this game. And impacts almost every aspect of it. I don't think you can really get how big a deal this is just hearing about it or reading the rules. You have to experience it. And one of the biggest parts of this is the fact that once you place your dice, they're stuck there until you get to act again.
Yeah, this is my favorite part of the game. I love the dice placement mechanics, and I love how it influences who we as a team pick to go first for the next round. Like, do you pick the player with the great card that you want to hurry up and get into play? Or do you go with someone who has a lot of 5s and 6s that's locking up the board so you can clear their dice and open up more opportunities for everyone? I like those decision points.
Yeah, this became the real meat of the game, honestly. That determination of turn order constantly evolving, more so than almost anything else, seemed to really engender a deep discussion between the players at the table. And of course, even once you determine what was going next, now the dice can mess up your well-laid plans.
So these mechanics, combined with the card play, how that works, does a really good job actually of mitigating a potential problem with cooperative games, and that is quarterbacking. Sure, you're going to discuss what options are best, but you usually don't have someone telling another player what to do on their turn exactly. I find keeping your hand of cards hidden does help as well. Now, the game does say You can play with them face up since it's cooperative, but then I find you get that whole, hey, you have that card, play it. I prefer to play them face up, but I fully encourage people who don't have that problem to play them either way. So I prefer to play them hidden.
The only reason I'd play them face up is if I was playing with younger kids, the helping component, but otherwise, no. It feels like a good mix of teamwork and making suggestions, and then there's still some choice there and some player agency, because these are my cards. You don't know what I'm going to plan.
Yeah, that asymmetry in the game, especially when keeping your hands to yourself, really does a lot to limit, if not eliminate, the quarterbacking. But because of how many aspects of the game you're trying to manage, a bigger problem can be almost too many people trying to quarterback things, with breeding, the UN, the action economy. All of it is important, and it's hard to decide how to spread out those limited resources. Everyone's going to have an opinion.
So here you have these great cooperative mechanics. Now you toss in a very tense set of bad things happen mechanics, and you end up with a very tight game. A game that, after the first year at least, things start feeling desperate, and the tension only ramps up as the game goes on. Every game we played of Endangered has been close. Every game we've won, we felt like we could have lost. And every time we've lost, we felt like we were close. I think once we played a game where by the time we got to the voting phase, we were guaranteed to win. Every other game, there's always been that chance, that random factor, that thing we may not just be able to pull off. And I love that. Losses in this game don't feel devastating. You don't feel like you got crushed by the game. There are some co-ops out there that are just too difficult. It always leaves me with that, we could have done it, let's play again.
Yeah, I actually like losing in this type of game. That feeling of, oh man, we almost made it, let's try again. It's very compelling. If it was a cakewalk, I would not find the game engaging.
And sadly, I think this is where the horrible reality of the game sets in. One of the important features of a good co-op is that difficulty level. And unfortunately, saving these animals, both in the game and in the real world, is staggeringly difficult to achieve.
Now, as we played more and gotten to know the cards and the strength of each role and who's good at what, the game has gotten easier. But honestly, that's not a problem, because we can always up the difficulty. Plus, we've found that every scenario plays very differently, and the strategies that work when you're trying to save the tigers are not the same ones that are going to work when you're trying to save the otters.
I think Mo understates this when he says they play differently. This isn't just a new map. No, this becomes a very different struggle with a different type of management required, even though the end goal, the fact that you need to get four people from the UN to vote for you is the same in every single game. But how that plays out.
Now, the stress and tension in Endangered is its biggest potential downfall. Board games are supposed to be fun, right? People talk about that all the time. Not everyone wants to be stressed out when playing a board game. And that's going to be, to me, the biggest consideration when trying to decide if this game is right for you and your group. That said, if you don't like a lot of tension in your games, there is the easy difficulty. And the scenarios we've seen, the easy difficulty tends to make it 3 votes instead of 4. But there are other scenarios that make it different than that. Now, we did try this once and I found it a little too easy, but it does make for that lighter, more family-friendly game feel that's more about saving the animals and how are you going to save them instead of will you save them.
Yeah, it's a wee bit stressful and the theme is a bit depressing. Like, yeah, we failed and all the otters died, and that could be a little sad for some folk, particularly younger kids. But then again, educational.
Now, another concern is the fact it's a cooperative game. Not every group enjoys games where the players have to rely on each other.
As I said above, I feel that the combination of dice and card play really works here to make me feel like we're working together as a team, but I still have some player agency. Like, okay, surprise, here's a cool card, I'm going to play this round. Or, oh crud, my die roll was really tragic, and now how am I going to mitigate this?
Yeah, now, one of the cooler aspects of Endangered is its expandability. As I was mentioning before, the two scenarios in the box play the same mechanically, yet feel very different at the table. And we know for a fact that other scenarios change the game up even more. It's also great to see that the game is still going and growing.
Yeah, I was super impressed with how different each scenario felt. And I'm looking forward to checking out the expansions.
Yeah, the community around this game has grown and developed their own scenarios as well, embracing the need for attention to a wide array of endangered species.
So overall, I've had a great time playing Endangered with my family. My mother-in-law and my oldest daughter love it. It's been a pretty big hit at our local public play events, where I got to say the components do a good job of drawing in a crowd. Everyone loves the animeeples.
They're super cute. Little tiny otters and tigers. Come on.
And again, I mean, otters. Need I say more?
Now, if you're a cooperative game fan and your group loves playing together to try to beat the game, I strongly recommend try to save some animals in Endangered. This is one of the best cooperative games I played, and it has a fantastic and important theme.
If you normally stay away from cooperative games, you may still want to give Endangered a try. We've had surprising success with this one, even with people who don't normally enjoy co-op games. Maybe see if your FLGS will do a demo. See if someone else local has it, or check out the print and play version. All you need are some D6 dice, which I'm sure you have some spares of lying around.
Now, if you or someone in your group doesn't like tense games where it can feel overwhelming or where the chances of winning feel slim, or there's a concern about the theme of animals being forced to extinction by the action of humans, you may want to avoid Endangered.
Then again, if you're bothered by the fact that humans are leading to the extinction of species, you might actually be the target for this game, as you should be bothered. And you should be taking actions to help support these animals at every step in the game and in real life.
So you can find Endangered at your friendly local game store, on Amazon, or get it directly from Grand Gamers Guild, where you can use our exclusive code Bellhop to save 10%.
So, as you all know, I am not a big fan of cooperative games, but I did enjoy this one. Are you like me and not a fan of playing cooperatively? What's a game that you ended up enjoying despite it being cooperative? Let us know about it in the comments below.
Or better yet, start up a conversation on our Discord server, which you can find at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.